Hey guys, today I'm going to do the field test for Momento dual tip markers by Sukiniko. These are typically considered to be stamping markers, but I don't know, I'm kind of just working my way through water-based twin tip markers, and I saw them on Marker Pop and I thought I'd give them a shot. So, as previously stated, these are twin-tipped markers, or dual-tipped. They have acid-free, I can't talk today, acid-free dye-based ink. They're fade-resistant. They dry on all paper surfaces, including coated and textured papers. And they recommend that you replace the cap after use. So unlike Crayolas, you can't leave these uncapped for months and expect them to work. And I ordered a scant handful in colors I thought would work for skin tones. You can tell that these are dye-based inks because this end has a plastic nib, and pigment inks don't work very well with those plastic nibs. They tend to use felt tip nibs, and there's also a nice large brush nib. I already did some swatching and watercolor testing a little while back, and as you can see by these swatches, a lot of these colors don't really disperse when water is added. So that's going to make today's swatch field test a little bit interesting. might have to work around some things. And I'm going to try and take photos as I test, since I know some of my readers from my blog they prefer to have a combination of written review and video review. So we'll see how that goes too. Now the colors that I have are, let's see, Rich Cocoa, Espresso Truffle, Summer Sky, Sweet Plum, Desert Sand, Toffee Crunch, Lulu Lavender, and New Sprout. And if you're a reader of my blog, you'll know that I actually hate this kind of naming, because sometimes it doesn't necessarily make sense. What one person thinks of as Toffee Crunch is not what another person thinks of as Toffee Crunch. And I actually prefer, like, beige and, I mean, lavender is fine, but the Lulu part is just, you know, it's a different demographic. Their demographic is not illustrators and fine artists. Their demographic is crafters. So I need to keep that in mind. And I'm just going to go grab a paper towel. Hang on a sec. Okay, as you can see, I have my desk set up. It's actually been set up for a couple of weeks. I was doing other things like video editing rather than finishing up this video because I needed to clear off my card. And that seemed to take forever. So I have my little masking tape side palette right here. I've taped down my piece of watercolor paper that's been inked with the Mitsuo Aida brush from Jet Pins. The Mitsuo Aida brush pen is both waterproof and Copic proof, and it's very handy. And before I go any further, I should say that this is not a sponsored video post. When I have a sponsored video post, you guys will know. All of the materials were purchased out of my own pocket. I don't receive any sort of reimbursement or compensation for these videos at this time. So this is done out of my own former Pokemon collecting, gotta catch them all mentality. Gotta catch all of the art supplies. So I'm going to start by rendering Kara's skin with desert sand, which is not really pale enough for her skin tone, but I didn't have a better marker for it. And I'm going to try applying it first to my side palette and see how that goes before I apply it directly to the skin, since these markers don't seem to blend out very well. And an application with water on brush seems to work okay. And keep in mind, these are more focused on stamping than on illustration. So I'm assuming when they say stamping markers, they mean to apply color to the stamp. since Tsukiniko makes a lot of scrapbooking and stamping sort of materials, tools. Sorry, I couldn't think of the word. I almost said paraphernalia. I mean, yeah, paraphernalia is technically a correct word for that, but that wasn't exactly the word I'd wanted. My video editor already put the word on me that I have to stop releasing, like, 4 videos in one fell swoop. I need to space them out better because it takes a lot of time to edit them. And I've been trying to produce videos that require less editing. With these, the field tests, the videos, I pretty much just want the logo slapped on and, like, the introduction music, and then that's that. And I'm actually really fortunate to have someone who's willing to edit my videos for me so I can do other things. He's already familiar with, he'd worked at a TV station for a while in undergrad or early college. I mean, I'm sorry, late high school. I'm sorry, Joseph, I don't necessarily remember which years you worked at the TV station. So he does have some experience with this kind of stuff. And his parents also run, like, a sports newspaper / they're kind of like a multimedia mini conglomerate right now for their area, because they also do, like, podcasts, and they have some television stuff, which is pretty cool. So he has experience in that, and I don't have experience in that. So he's very kind to edit my videos for me. So I'm already layering color, and I'm getting some areas that are darker than others. Let me try to zoom in. There. It's actually, I'm sorry, the color's turning up really, really poor in this video. So you might want to double check the blog post. And that reminds me, I should take a video, or I'm sorry, a photo right now. Because I have so many lights going on, it's hard for you guys to see, but I'm trying to get rid of, like, overwhelming shadows. And some of my other videos have, like, shots of my head in them, like the inking videos, because my eyesight's really poor and my glasses don't fit anymore, so I have to be on top of what I'm doing, which is fine if nobody's can see that I have to be on top of what I'm doing, but it's definitely distracting for you guys, I think. So, I already like these markers a little bit better than the Recollections Masterpiece 2 markers from Michaels and the Paper Source Brilliant Brush water-based markers that I did a field test for recently. And they're not perfect, and I am kind of cheating in how I'm using them. I think a more fair test of the markers would probably be straight on the paper and see how that goes, but I already, due to my swatches, I already knew that wouldn't necessarily give me results that I could use, so I thought this would be the best way to go about doing it. And I'm starting to see more and more people do a faux watercolor like this anyway, so it makes me feel a little bit better that I'm not cheating you guys of information you need to know. I mean, I am getting some kind of strange, harsh lines, and I'm going to take a photo of that for the blog, because I don't think it's showing up in the video very well. I'm kind of a butterfingers today. I don't know why, other than I've had coffee and I haven't eaten. I mean, it's not so bad. It's kind of an interesting effect if you are not overly, I tend to be overly precious sometimes with how things line up, how things look, the way the lines are. And I know some of you guys are not, you prefer a more loose style anyway, which I think is great. Like, I really like it. I'm just, it's harder for me to do that kind of stuff because it doesn't look as good when I do it. So this might not even be a problem for you. And I don't remember offhand what I paid for these. So you're going to have to, if you're one of my viewers, you're going to have to go check the blog. Or you could Google it. I mean, there's, I got them from Marker Pop, if that helps. They carry an interesting variety of markers, so I have bought a lot of markers from them over the years, but they're not a sponsor of my blog or my YouTube channel, so it's not that I owe them a particular alliance of any sort. They just carry an interesting array of markers. I also like Carpe Diem markers a lot. They carry Japanese brands like Neopico and, what is it called? I reviewed them. They were like the short alcohol-based markers that had three tips, and it'll come to me when the video's done. Isn't that how it goes? So I check both of them for new stuff fairly regularly, like once a month at least. Their prices are also very fair, and they carry a lot of open stock stuff, which is one of my complaints about jet pens, is they don't carry as much open stock stuff as I would like, and often the colors they have are just not useful to me unless I buy a big set. And for testing purposes, I really don't want to buy a big set. I just really want to get some decent skin tones so I can then decide if I want to buy a big set. I didn't get any red, and she's got an open mouth. Should have just drawn her with a closed mouth smile. And I'm trying to take photos as I go for those readers who are not into. Ooh, this one's mushy already. Ah, that's so disappointing. It was a brand new marker. And the tip's mushy already. Like, I think I used it only to do the swatch test, and that's it. Quality control issues. Mushy markers are bad for direct application because you can't achieve as fine a detail as you would like. So, and I know these are twin tipped, but I tend to rely primarily on the brush nib because it gives better blended strokes. And I also often have problems with like the fine nibs, like ink not coming out or colors blending, not blending as well as they would from the larger tip, or the color being greatly different. Enough that I would just rather not deal with it. I mean, for testing for you guys, of course I'm going to deal with it, because that's part and parcel of what this is. But for my own purposes, I'm going to directly apply this Lulu lavender to these little purple daisies. We used to get these in my yard in Louisiana, and since this character, Kara, her story is set in Hawnville, Louisiana, which is like 15 minutes away from where I grew up, in the house my mom grew up in, which is a cool house. I thought I would draw her with them, because they're very cute. And they remind me, these and Clover really remind me of like Louisiana backyard in the middle of summer, which is where and when this story takes place. No, my grandfather wasn't necessarily a traditional artist or even an architect, but he designed the house he lived in, and he designed some of the buildings for their parish church, and he liked to draw cartoons and comics. I don't know. I just always thought that's my mom's father, and my dad was really good at like funny caricatures of like celebrities and stuff. So I grew up, my papa didn't talk about drawing, like, ever. I found out from my grandmother after he had died, which kind of made me sad, because that would have been a thing we could have bonded over. We didn't necessarily have a lot in common that I knew about when I was a kid. But my dad would draw for me, like, all the time. Some of my fondest memories are like watching Nickelodeon with my dad and asking him to draw like Mark Summers and stuff from Double Dare. My dad's gone too now, so I guess the going into illustration, going into comics is kind of like a weird way for me to remember my family. I don't know, it helps you keep them in your heart. You think about them when you're drawing, you talk about them when you're drawing. Sorry. I'm gonna like get all emotional on YouTube and you guys are gonna think I'm crazy. So far these markers are okay. I wish I'd made better color selections. I think I remember these markers having kind of a limited selection because they're for stamping rather than for rendering. Which is not really the fault of the markers. It's the fault of the Becca for buying the markers. I think I want to directly apply some desert sand for shadows. And I also was working off of like a digital swatch, which, I mean, my monitor is color calibrated, so it's accurate, but it doesn't necessarily mean their scanner is, or, I mean, you know, when you're buying markers online, you just have to like kind of have your swatch book handy, but also kind of just be okay with what you get. Try not to be disappointed. And as you can see, with a direct application, it doesn't blend out, the water pushes in. So, I mean, it's not great, but I'm really glad I didn't, like, apply the desert. Excuse me, I'm sorry. I didn't apply desert sand as, like, an all-over kind of thing, but rather as, like, a shading kind of thing. So this is totally not relevant to you guys, because, I mean, the video might be up on YouTube, but the post isn't going to be written until, like, I mean, the post is half drafted, but the post won't be written and up on my blog until, I want to say, like, January, because my December queue is already kind of getting full with some Copic tutorials I've been working on. But... dang it, this upcoming weekend I have a little one-day show that I'm flying to New Orleans for. I currently live in the Tennessee area, Nashville area, sorry, which I love. Like, I love Nashville. The people here are really great. Like, I love doing shows here. They're always so nice. They really like my work. But New Orleans is, like, where I grew up, kind of. I grew up in Luling, 40 minutes away. New Orleans is where we spent our time because Luling has literally nothing at all to do except Walmart. And a Dollar Tree, in school, which wasn't, yeah. Anyway, so I go back to Louisiana a lot for shows and stuff, and, I don't know, I always go in with, like, weird hopes, and I don't really have the right to have those hopes, to be honest, because I moved away, and Louisiana is very, like, self-proud, right? So, like, if you move away... unless you're super famous, you're kind of a little bit of a it's kind of like, why should we count you as one of our own? You left us, you went elsewhere. It's like a jealous girlfriend or a jealous parent. And it's like, well, there isn't a comic industry in New Orleans, and there aren't necessarily good job opportunities unless you're related to somebody. And I would have to travel anyway, and Nashville is a little bit better able to support me financially. I make a little bit more money here than I do at shows in New Orleans. And there are more shows in this area. I'm closer to things here than I was in Louisiana, and I'd love to move back. Like, my mom and brother live in Louisiana. My heart is there. I, you know, I'll always love it. I set my comics there because I miss it. I just need to have more income that isn't dependent on proximity, and that's not my life right now, so I can't move back right now. gosh, that's kind of cute. I do say so myself. I usually do a direct application with hair and eyes, but I think what I'm going to do for right now is I'm going to put a layer. Oh, I should double check. Let's see, what are you? You're rich cocoa. Rich cocoa looks like this, and toffee crunch looks like this, and espresso truffle is like almost black. And see, I drink a lot of coffee, and I wouldn't think of espresso truffle as being that black. I would think of it as more of like a warm brown. More like this color than like that color. So the caps are not 100%. Oh man, rich truffle is like the worst. I'm sorry, toffee crunch is the worst, right? Toffee crunch looks like, cap-wise, it's about the same color as desert sand. Nope, it's like less saturated, it's slightly darker. I mean, it's a good like freckle color, and Kara has freckles, so it works out, but it's not a good... And since I might as well just do the freckles all over the place today. I'm sorry. I feel really chatty, like I want to talk. And I want to talk to you guys about my life and stuff. But I am also doing this. So I am applying freckles with toffee crunch. And I mean, it's okay. And I'm using like my normal painting brushes. Like this is a Creative Mark Rhapsody size 2 Kolinsky brush. So I'm like using good enough. I'm using good materials, like what I would use to paint. And I usually use for the field tests. I usually use the same materials I would paint with. Not like, I mean, synthetic brushes are fine, and I know a lot of people who use synthetic brushes, and I have some, but they're always too stiff. They don't hold enough water for me, or like a water brush. I see people do beautiful things with water brushes, and I can't. Like, it looks terrible when I use a water brush. Just horrible. There's also, I'm taking a photo of it for you guys' reference, but there's like a line of desaturation where I tried to blend, desert sand, my skin tone, out with water on the paper. And I mean, it looks okay for this, but I'm not gonna call it a feature. It's definitely a flaw. Anyway, I was talking about Noka's Fest to you guys, and I'm just darkening up certain areas with the direct application of desert sand that I'm not going to blend out. I'm just gonna be cool with it. Trying to hide how striking that line is. Anyway, Noka's Fest is a recent invention. It's a one-day mini Comic-Con in New Orleans, Louisiana. And I did it last year, and I didn't necessarily make a lot of money. There weren't necessarily a lot of people there to buy. There were a lot of people tabling, and they were kind of like hidden amongst the stacks of books, given how it was laid out, because they're utilizing the New Orleans Public Library's upstairs space, which isn't actually a lot of room. And I'm a little surprised it's not downstairs, but it's also Louisiana, so I'm also kind of not surprised. That sounds awful. I should give you some context. So I've donated some copies of the comic I've worked on to the St. Charles Parish Library branch library system. That's where I grew up. And first of all, the Luling Library still doesn't have a comic section. Some of the other branches in that system have comic collections, but they're kind of small. Secondly, I've like tried to volunteer to talk to their kids about comic arts, and it's like pulling teeth to get a response out of anybody. I had to contact a friend from high school about it. Like, it's like embarrassing. Like, it's like, wow, am I that bad? But I think it's really just mostly there's a persistent belief that comics are not literature still in that part of Louisiana. Maybe a lot more of Louisiana. I mean, when I was in undergrad, I was a fine art major at a school that didn't even have an illustration focus because Hurricane Katrina just kind of like wiped their budget as soon as I got there, and my parents weren't going to let me switch schools. I went to UNO for the record. And, like, my professors really liked my work, but they were really disappointed that I decided to go into comics. So it's like I grew up in an environment that was really not comics friendly. So even though it's been 10 years and I'm sad when I hear this kind of stuff from other people, it doesn't surprise me at all. And that's kind of why it's so important, why I like fight so hard to go back, why I go back to do shows like MechaCon and Noka's Fest, because like I spend probably as much as I make on airfare and hotel stuff, right? Like, it's not like it's like a big money-making opportunity, but I feel like people need to come back to Louisiana and they need to talk about what they're doing, especially when they work in creative fields outside of music, because we just don't, people leave Louisiana and they don't come back, or they stay in Louisiana but they leave for shows and they don't ever talk to anybody about what they're doing, or they don't do local conventions because there's no money there. And it's like, well, how are you going to change what people think if we can't show them that it's possible? Hard, but possible. So, I mean, Noka's Fest wasn't even a thing when I was an undergrad, because I totally would have done it then, when I was still able to, like, kind of be part of the scene. And now I live far away, and I have to, when I go back for that particular show, I stay with my mom in Luling to, like, save money on hotel and stuff. And it's just really, it's hard to juggle that kind of stuff, because my family is, like, staunchly no drinking, and, for reasons, good reasons. And, like, those kind of events, most events in Louisiana, most events in New Orleans are very centered around drinking or being around a lot of alcohol, and it's just, like, it's hard for me. I would like to attend those kind of events so I can talk to other comic people, so I can talk to other creators from Louisiana. Like, I think it's important, but I don't have any desire to be hanging out around a bunch of drunk people, necessarily. It's not really fun when you're sober. And I also just, like, as a children's illustrator, or my focus is kids illustration, I also don't necessarily think that's, like, the best time to talk to other creatives. And I know there are a lot of people who can drink and draw, and they can drink and talk about their work, and I'm just not going to be one of them. So I'm excited, but it's also an expensive opportunity that didn't necessarily go all that well last year, but I want to help make it go better this year, so I'm putting my money where my mouth is. And I'm kind of bummed because I probably won't be able to do any of the events, because it's like a 40-minute drive into the city, and I'd be borrowing my brother's Jeep, and I drive this little Jetta, and his Jeep is always top heavy. So it's like just like a sad combination of things where I'm just like, well, I guess I can go and sit at the table, but unless someone is going to watch my stuff for me, I can't necessarily get up to and talk to people. And a lot of the other people tabling last year didn't get up to talk to people either. It's sad. It's sad for me. No, I mean, the event is a good event, and I want to see it grow. And I have a lot of respect for the organizers, because they're doing something that isn't easy. Organizing artists, getting money from artists, finagling our idiosyncrasies is not easy, and it's probably not fun. I don't enjoy that in that aspect of what I do. So I have a lot of respect for them. I just, you know, I wish I could participate more fully, and there are a lot of reasons why I can't do so. But none of them stem from a lack of desire. All of them stem from location and the sort of events they're holding as after events. And I guess I ought to, like, I don't know, for, like, the three of us, who aren't drinkers, I ought to be like, let's go hang out at a coffee shop or something. I don't know. But, like, since I'm not driving, like, someone else is driving me, I feel weird about that. Unless they have their own transportation. I don't know. I probably overthink everything. I goofed right there. Right there. Because I'm too busy talking, you guys, and not talking about this product that I'm testing. I don't know. I feel like at this point, they're okay. They're not the best. They're probably a little expensive, a little difficult to get a hold of, considering how many other brands are out there. I'm not necessarily using them for their intended use. I'll probably be more coherent in the blog post, so you should definitely check that out, especially because I'm probably not going to give like a final opinion on camera, just because like I would like to think about it. Man, this mushy marker is so wrecked, and it's not doing a good job putting down color, and it makes me sad because I paid normal non-wrecked marker price for it. Anyway, I wanted to get this test done before I left because I didn't want it sitting on my drafting table for like a week while I'm out of town. And I've also been busy putting together like an Inktober mini called Favorite Fictional Femmes. But I got really excited and I kept thinking of all these other female characters who have been like hugely inspirational or influential to me or my work that I wanted to include, so I ended up doing like 10 more illustrations in like 4 days, plus the cover, plus the layout. So I'm going to go to Office something, Office Max, Office Depot, they've become one and the same now, and get those printed tonight and assemble them tonight, because I'm going to a Sufjan Stevens concert tomorrow, and then I fly out for New Orleans on Thursday, and there's just like no way I'm going to be able to get this kind of work done at my mom's house unless I brought all the supplies. Because my life as a comic artist really, I mean, I had like cardstock and stuff like that as a kid, but like I didn't have a scanner or a printer or this other stuff that's kind of important for assembling stuff until grad school. So I don't have any of that at her house. I have that all here. Time to use that horrible, mushy, disappointing marker. I don't know if I should be sad at Tsukiniko for their crummy marker, or if I should be sad at Marker Pop for selling me a crummy marker and not checking. I hope they didn't. I think they have a physical store, and I really hope I didn't get, like, floor stock, because unless they test it for you, then I'm cool with like, floor open stock. I'm just not cool with it when they just grab. I like to think they can't. Their mail stuff comes from the back because they understand that you can't be there in person to make sure you're not getting a broken pen. I mean, when I buy markers in person at stores, I always check. Because I feel like if I get, like, a broken marker at that in that scenario, well, that's my fault because I was physically there. What color should I make the body of her dress? She's already got the... I don't have, like, a large selection of colors. Kind of like her hair the way it is, and I kind of feel like espresso truffle would just, like, bork it. These also tout that they're fast drying, which, I mean, for, okay, if you're familiar with water-based markers, you know that you, if you want to do blending, if you want to do layering without wrecking your paper, A, you need paper that can take it, and B, you kind of need to wait a little while because it's wet. It's the wet paper that abrades and gets pilly and wrecked. So in that case, I'm happy that it's fast drying, but I'm also curious as to what they're made with because, I mean, it doesn't seem, if it's fast drying, then it's probably not a water-based marker, but it doesn't smell like it's got like an alcohol additive. I don't know. I really sincerely do. I try to find this information out because I am legitimately curious and I want to write about it. But I have a lot of difficulty finding what some things are made of. Like, it took a lot of digging to find out what Crayola watercolors are probably, like, best guess made out of. I still don't know. I mean, they claim they're water-based, and they are water-based. But there's something else, I think, in Crayola markers that, besides just water and dye. And I'm pretty sure the Up and Up markers have a lot of glycerin in them, which I actually really like because you can blend them. And if you check out my blog in January, maybe even late December, when I start my Target art supply review series, like I've already, the posts are written, the photos are taken, I just need to upload them into the blog. And I didn't want to go from one cheap art supply review series to another cheap art supply review series. At least not without people, like, writing in and telling me, but it's still kind of difficult for me to get people to write in and talk to me, because I bite. So, I just kind of used my best judgment and decided, I'm using the, like, not broken end. It's alright. Not great. It's very scrubby. So, if your paper isn't dry, it will tear up your paper. It will ruin your paper. Because it's like a very stiff plastic nib. It's meant for very fine details or like lettering things. And in that capacity, I respect it. I'm down with it. I just like don't, I'm not into it at all for illustration purposes. And even with the water added, it does dry pretty quick. So maybe it is just water. So yeah, indie comic convention in Louisiana next weekend for me. And I want to say I'm excited about it, but I'm a little bit anxious because I have to go do my books today. And I never know how that's going to go. We had a really good Office Max where they listened to what you were actually getting and they didn't just, like, blow you off as not knowing what you're talking about. And they would do test prints. But before that, I went to my, like, literally right next door Office Depot, where I have had nothing but horrible experiences, and they don't listen to you. And even if you write down what you want for them, they don't do it. And the last time I went, the manager had to get involved because it was just so wrong. Like, what the guy did, he just didn't listen to anything I said at all, and he sent me away for an hour so he could get it done. And I'd written it all down for him, and he left it on the desk, and I come back, and it's all wrong, and he still wants me to pay for it, and the manager ends up getting involved, and I point out the sticky note where I'd written everything down, he's checking through, and he's like, yeah, if you had done these things, it would have been what she was looking for, so that's our fault, we have to eat this. So it took like 4 hours to print like 10 booklets that I mean, I'm not talking about assemble and cut, I mean just print. So I'm not really looking forward to like finding out whether or not finding a new Office Max, because the one I liked is now closed. So it's anybody's guess as to whether or not their other locations are any good. and I'm probably going in a couple of hours, so we'll find out. There's like a Starbucks next door, so I guess I could like go hang out at the Starbucks once we get everything kind of like figured out. I don't know. I need to get reprints of Magical Girl March, my March Challenge anthology. And I'm getting reprints of Artistically Challenged, my 2014, spring of 2015 sketchbook. And I'm getting never before done prints of Favorite Fictional Femmes. And these are all for Nocus Fest, because even though I have a comic, like a print comic, I wanted to offer more like dollar, $2 stuff, because sometimes that's what sells. Sometimes that's all that sells. And that's okay, that's fine. I'd rather comics than like fan art, even if I'm making less money, because at least it's my stuff. Okay, so some of the markers, the color dispersion, you guys can't see. Man, it is so blown out for y'all. You're gonna have to check the blog. And I'm taking lots of photos. But because these are quote-unquote quick drying, some of the color dispersion is really weird. Like, it's hard to apply a uniform wash with these. So if you're one of those artists who wants to quickly fake a watercolor look, which, like, to me always implies, like, uneven distribution of color pooling, just, like, a very digital approach to watercolor. These are great because they perform non-consistently. It is hard to get consistent results out of them. You very quickly get that. But if you are trying to use them for something a little more serious, like faces, where the splotching looks terrible and weird, you don't want these. And a direct application of this would be as dark as those pom-poms. And once the dress dries, I'm actually going to go back and darken up the pom-poms a little bit so that they stand out more against the dress. The outfit, the dress that inspired this is actually not mine, something I saw on Pinterest, but very brightly colored, very cute. I thought it would look really cute on a little person like Kara. Okay, I'm gonna let this dry a little bit and probably add some blue in the background and darken up the pom-poms, and that might be it. I'm not sure if I should pause this or just like chat at you guys. I mean, it's not like you can see my face, so. And you can't, I don't think you can see it on the video, but there's like some color separation here on that purple. And I'm going to take a photo of it, so you should check out the blog if you need to see it. And that was Sweet Plum. And in my swatch, I was having a lot of trouble getting color dispersion when trying to, like, move the ink that had been applied directly to the paper with water. And it's a little bit easier to get it to move by using this side palette thing I set up, but it's still not perfect. And, if you're looking for watercolor markers or markers that can be used both as markers and watercolors, I recommend Zig Art and Graphic Twin over these, and I recommend Tombow ABTs over these. Oh man, I need to like do like a blending test with the Tombow to see if they're compatible. And if you enjoy these kinds of video, like art supply review videos, and you don't currently read my blog, I really, really do recommend it. I know I sound biased, but I've been writing it for 6 years. There are hundreds of reviews and tutorials on it at this point. I also write about conventions and do convention reviews if you're like a convention kind of person, like a comic or anime kind of person who wants to table or does table and maybe you're new to the Southeast area and you want to know what cons are good. I've done a bunch of cons and I've written about a bunch of cons. So if you aren't a reader, I recommend you check out netasoup.com. And I'm going to put a card in the annotations for you guys. And I'll probably link it in the description below. The video reviews are kind of a new thing for me. Mostly because it is a big pain to... it was really getting on my nerves trying to write and take photos and do the field tests. And I also wanted to expand my audience. And I also, there are a lot of people on YouTube who review supplies. A lot of them are crafters, so I wanted to add kind of the more illustrator approach just to help people like myself better be able to decide. And I mean, a lot of the reviews are for like Copics and stamps, so it's... I wanted to try and also bring some variety to it. But it honestly takes me a little bit longer to decide than a single video, than like the hour I record a video in. How long is this one gonna be? 46 minutes. Then the 46 or so, I'll say an hour. Ugh, sorry, that was my phone. Then the hour, it takes me longer than the hour it takes to do this test and talk to you guys for me to decide whether or not I like a product. Because sometimes I'll like go back and think of another use and try it with that use. I mean, there's some products that I've tested, like the Payson marker paper, where I do like 4 or 5 different tests with it, where I will like test different. I did like Crayolas on it, and I did Crazy Art markers on it. And I did Copics on it, and I did like inking review on it, because it's actually great to ink on. Like, it's a nice paper for that. It's just not good for markers. Not the best for markers, but it's cheap. You can get it at Walmart. So if that is a thing you care about, that's an important thing, I guess. Anyway, there are some things that I do several tests on, so it would be impossible for me to like give a recommendation based on an hour's worth of video. And I mean, some of these products cost so much money. If you're buying them out of pocket, you really need more than an... You need, if you're looking up reviews, if you care enough to look up reviews, you need more than like somebody's 15 minutes of like, well, this was donated, or I have a sponsor and I'm just opening it now. And like, that's like a fine introduction to a product you didn't know existed, but that's not, that isn't a good enough endorsement to dump $30 to buy like 3 pans, or, you know, in my opinion, my 2 cents worth of nothing. I don't really think that, especially for like younger artists, high school, early undergrad, where you just don't have a lot of money to spend. Like, I feel bad for you guys, because some of the reviews that are out there, man, you're gonna, if you trust them, you're wasting your money, because they literally open the product on air and within 10 minutes they tell you whether or not you should, it's a good product. Like, how would you even know? You like sprinkled a little bit of it on top of a thing you stamped. That's not necessarily, especially for the ones who are like, and I've never used anything like this before. It's like, why are you giving an opinion then? Other than the company sending it to them. I mean, it's different if they've been like, you know, they like use a lot of markers, right? Like, you can usually tell, I would say, within a swatch test, I can tell whether or not a marker is gonna be good or not. Sorry. I just have overly strong opinions on that kind of thing. If all your supplies are sponsored by a company and you're only dedicating like 10 minutes to actually talk, if you spend more time editing the video than you do playing around with the product, and you don't have a history with similar products, it just really makes me wonder if your opinion should be taken all that seriously. Seriously, if you know enough about the product for the company to actually sponsor you, which I guess is shots fired. I'm sorry. So, yeah, those are Memento dual markers made by Tsukiniko. They are stamping markers. They have a twin tip. One tip is a brush. One tip is a small detail plastic nib, which can tear up the paper if your paper is wet. The brush tip is denoted by a black band, which you are probably going to have trouble seeing, very similar to Copic's gray band or other alcohol markers. They have posting caps. The brush cap end is flared. The other cap is... other cap. The fine point cap is not. The markers are written on the barrel on the right by... Oh, no. This is a sticker. The marker names may not be written on the barrel. The marker names might be applied via sticker. So they're using the same barrel for all their markers and then putting a sticker on it, which is fine. I got these off of Marker Pop. They are not a sponsor. My opinions are my own. They are based off of years of experience with working with watercolor, with working with markers, with working with markers that are both markers and watercolors. You can read the rest of this review, including my verdict on nattosoup.blogspot.com, probably sometime in January. I highly recommend you check it out now, though, because there's lots of great stuff up there, lots of great reviews. I'm currently kind of working my way through scrapbooker supplies, because I have strong opinions about... the possibility of taking advantage of people who might not know better with subpar supplies. Some of the supplies I bought have really impressed me, and some of them have just really made me annoyed that they're kind of taking advantage of their audience. These are stamping markers. I am not a stamper. I am an illustrator. If you are a stamper and you really like these markers and you can explain to me why they're great, I would be more than happy to include your opinion in my post. I would hate to misrepresent a product just because I don't know how to use it or I'm making an assumption as to what it could be used for. So I think that's everything. I hope you guys have a good day. Goodbye.